Circumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his field. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.' And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to you, listens to me. And whoever rejects you, rejects me. And whoever rejects me, rejects the one who sent me.' The 70 returned with joy, saying, 'Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us.' He said to them, 'I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven.' The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
With great humility here also significant for our parish, for those two things apply in our search for a new priest. We are sent and we have to cross some boundaries. And we find that the very first sentence of the Gospel tells us that Jesus sent disciples ahead of him, because he was to join them later. We also know that Jesus himself was sent. And we also know and remember that John the Baptist was also sent before Christ. And so now we also can say that our parish is sent on a mission to find a new priest. So I like to sort of think of readings with this background. I perhaps be a bit repetitive, but I know we all can find our own theme. And the second theme, the image of crossing boundaries, is very clear in St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, where he argues against circumcision for early Christians. It is also very prominent in Jesus' message to his disciples, on which he sent them. He's asked them to overcome many of their habits. And for us, it would certainly help us to imagine and assess which boundaries, which patterns of thinking or our practices we could change or we should change in our quest for a new priest. And what would be the result of those of being sent, the idea of being sent, of crossing boundaries? It is my belief that they both lead to transformative change of our hearts. They allow us to look at from different perspective, from a different vantage point to our own situation. Therefore, I would like to narrow my reflection to those two topics, but also obviously the readings offer many other, it's almost timeless wisdom included in the scriptures. And my goal is to present some details of the background of Christ's ministry in Palestine, and hoping that by analyzing some only few details, we will find nourishment for our needs and our quest. The Gospel tells us that Jesus sent out 70 disciples to the neighboring communities to prepare for his coming. The number of 70 includes that the group was much larger than the core number of his disciples, which were 12. And so just like Christ now was sending disciples, somebody else was sent before him. And we can read in Mark's Gospel, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And it is not coincidental that today's reading indirectly alludes to St. John the Baptist, because just last week we celebrated the feast of St. John. But now we see that Jesus Christ is sending his disciples to transform people's heart so that they themselves would be able to hear the message from Jesus himself. And the passage in the Gospel is the events which are presented in today's reading are just before Jesus. their coming was announced by heavenly messengers. It was an angel who told John's father, Zechariah, that his wife, although very advanced in age, will bear a child, who shall turn many of the sons of Israel to the Lord, their God, and that he will turn their hearts, to be prepared for the Lord. And the same gospel, Luke gospel, tells us that the angel Gabriel announced to Mary that she soon will carry a child, Jesus, who shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and that his kingdom shall never end. So one could say that we parishioners have two missions. One is to use our talents and skills in our service to society. And the other mission as Christians, we are preordained by the deed of Christ, by his passion and his resurrection. We are preordained to carry on his mission, the mission of love. Thus, in our lives, we should reconcile both callings: the calling of service to society through our own internal actions, and the internal one, the one of service to Christ through the transformation of our hearts. So we have one theme, and the second theme, the crossing of the boundaries. What boundaries did Jesus and John the Baptist overcame? Both individuals went beyond many habits, many rituals, and rules of the community to which they were born. Both spent time in solitude, in the wilderness, and both of their hearts were transformed. Thus we can ask ourselves, what tasks, commitments, or callings shall we undertake to transform our own hearts? The number of the disciples mentioned in the Gospel, 70, is a symbolic. There are some manuscripts of the Gospel which mention 72, but the scholars disagree which one is correct. Most of the scholars mention that it should be 70, because the number 70 is mentioned in the book of Genesis as the number of 70 different nations which inhabited the earth after the big flood, and all those nations were descendants of Noah and his three sons. Thus, we see that by selecting a group of 70 rather than just 12, Jesus Christ implies that in the group of his missionaries are included all ethnic groups of the earth. Therefore, we could say that he transcended the boundaries of nationhood. It is also worth mentioning another detail implied in today's gospel reading. To reach Jerusalem, Jesus and his disciples had to pass through Decapolis, which was an autonomous community, autonomous state, where Greeks, Arameans, and Jews lived together. So it was a multinational place where the dominant culture was not the Jewish culture, but was rather the Greek. understand why Jesus tells his disciples, remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. And he also says, eat what is before you. It is an important message Jesus is giving his messengers. He is encouraging them to free themselves from ritual prescriptions and accept the norm of the land. Jesus is encouraging the disciples to cross the boundaries of what was acceptable or not acceptable to eat as decreed by the religious precepts. As if he was encouraging them to open themselves to what others could offer. We can thus imagine that the disciples had to undergo an inner transformation, a transformation in their hearts, before they could make themselves receptive to their hosts and the host's unfamiliar food. So transposing this image, the image of the disciple standing in front of aliens who spoke different languages, exhibited different habits, and offered unknown foods, to our contemporary lives, what image comes to our minds? Have we ever found ourselves in an entirely new surrounding with many unknowns? Were we able to talk to a stranger or a homeless on a street? There is a saying, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. Are we able to incorporate that? I myself, when I make a small personal note, being a wandering immigrant, I had to learn the languages of a few countries I lived, and I had to be attentive to new habits. I am sure I made many blunders, many misjudgments and errors. I am also sure that I could not always stay open-minded or receptive to the environment. Yet I have always tried. The Gospel reading offers yet another image, namely Jesus' requirement that the disciples abandon their comfort items and fill themselves with gentleness. And Luke is saying, see, and this is Jesus' words, see, I am sending you like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. The image of the messengers traveling on foot without extra clothing, without an additional change, and donned, if we may say so, with features of a meek lamb, fills us, the residents of the 21st century in America, with disbelief. Do we go grocery shopping without our iPhones? Are we able to go on vacation without securing in advance plane or train ticket and all necessary amenities in the place we would stay? I would dare to say, though, that in our external activities, we do need our smartphones. They provide us many conveniences we never could have had before. We also need to plan our trips, either we go on vacations or on business. I believe truly inside. So we could ask ourselves what situations made us turn completely inward. When did we accept a situation in which did not offer us a safe place, yet we could maintain peace in our hearts? Isn't it our parish now when Providence sent us on the search of a new priest just in that condition? We are asked to follow a process, yet we should also remember that the transformation of our hearts in the face of many insecurities and unknowns is needed. I would like to mention another boundary crossing, very powerfully mentioned in St. Paul's reading to the letter to the Galatians. And St. Paul tells us, "May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything." Those are powerful words. Here the apostle to the Gentiles tells us that for him, the external form of circumcision is not essential, neither it should be for Christians. We should be aware that the circumcision was powerful, was a sign, was a symbol of, for the Jewish people of the covenant to Yahweh. And it had to be a very significant symbol for early Christians, because they themselves were Jewish. Christ is Jewish. The apostles and St. Paul himself and Pharisees convincingly argued that we should not be bound by external forms only. On the contrary, it is the Christ, his spirit, which should work internally in us. Or rather, we should allow the Christ to work in us. And in this aspect, we should recognize the guidance for ourselves and ask, do we cling to some habitual forms or old patterns of thinking? Can we initiate a new creation, including a new creation from our quest for a new priest? I would like to conclude these reflections with a thought that whatever inner transformation each one or our parish would undergo, it could only be granted to us by Christ himself.
Say together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father of the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, church, its members, and its mission. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the nation, the commonwealth, and all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the welfare of the world and stewardship of creation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the concerns of the local community, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer and those in any trouble, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins. For our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Alrighty, so announcements will be short and sweet. We're still looking for help with mowing the grass. There's a sign up out in the foyer. Next week is Second Soap Sunday, so you can bring those for donations. We'd also like to thank Maria for her reflection. That's great. I'd also like to give you just a quick little search committee update since I'm up here and I'm the only one here. I'm sorry, John's here for the search committee too. So we've been going through the last several weeks and meeting once a week. We've been getting some preparation work done, kind of coalescing as a group, and also working on some questions that we're going to be bringing out to parish a couple at a time. I think every couple weeks is probably the cadence we'll do it. But that's going to kind of take us through the summer, and these are things to kind of prime the pump for September when we are all back, and we had the Welcome Back picnic and that, and at that point we're going to be starting to do meetings similar to what we've done before with discernments, appreciative inquiries, that sort of thing. Those are all going to inform a parish profile that we'll fill out. That will go up to a website that I kind of liken it to a match.com kind of thing where both the parish and prospective priests can both look at it and they see what our profile looks like. We see what their individual resume, that's the word for it, look like, and we begin talks there with folks that we're thinking are potentially a good fit we'd want to talk to further. So we are working throughout the summer, like I said. It's mainly prep work, but come September, we're going to be really engaging everybody. So I want to thank you for that. Is there anything else? No? All right.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Together, Almighty God,
Father
of all mercies, we, your unwilling servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and the blessings of this life. But above all, your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Brotherhood.